Welcome back students. This is the second lecture on the chapter of ultrasonics. In the first chapter we had studied about some basics of ultrasonics and what are meant by ultrasonic waves. So ultrasonic waves are basically sound waves which are having a frequency greater than 20,000 hertz. So now we are going to see how to produce ultrasonic waves. We are going to study the first method called is the magnetostriction method. So first we are going to study what is the meaning of this phenomena called as magnetostriction. Now, remember one thing, as I told you in the introductory lecture, all sounds are produced by vibrations, okay? So every sound is produced by an object which is vibrating. Whenever we hear some sound, there will always be an object which is vibrating. So same thing with ultrasonics also. They are also sound waves. Only difference between ultrasonic waves and normal sound waves is that ultrasonic waves, we cannot hear them, but they have all the properties of sound waves. So ultrasonic waves are also produced by vibrating objects. So in the generation of ultrasonic waves, to produce ultrasonic waves, we also have to make an object to vibrate. Vibrate at what rate? At a frequency greater than 20,000. So if we are able to make an object to vibrate at a frequency greater than 20,000 hertz, we will be able to produce ultrasonic waves. So this is the principle behind production of ultrasonic waves. Whether it's magnetostriction method or the next method, piezoelectric method, what will be common in both these methods is that we are going to make an object to vibrate at a rate greater than 20,000 hertz. So coming back to magnetostriction, what is magnetostriction? So it's a phenomena which is exhibited by any ferromagnetic rod, like for example iron, nickel, cobalt. You take any ferromagnetic rod of these materials, iron, nickel or cobalt. So most common example is iron. So most common ferromagnetic material is iron. So let us take an iron rod, and when you place this iron rod in a magnetic field parallel to its length. So we are going to place this iron rod in a magnetic field parallel to its length. So if the rod is in this direction, we are going to apply the magnetic field also in the same direction, or this direction, either parallel or anti-parallel, so along the length of the rod. So what happens then? So when you apply a magnetic field along the length of a ferromagnetic rod, the length of the rod changes. It either becomes bigger in size or becomes smaller in size. So the length of the rod will either increase or it will decrease. So the rod will slightly become bigger in size, both sides, or it may become smaller in size. So the rod either increases in length or decreases in length. This phenomena is called as magnetostriction. So once again, what is magnetostriction? It is a phenomena wherein a ferromagnetic rod placed in a magnetic field applied along its length, the length of the rod changes, either increases or decreases. So this phenomena is called as magnetostriction. Now, a few features about magnetostriction is that the change in length of the rod does not depend upon the direction of the applied magnetic field. So whether you apply the field parallel to the length or anti-parallel to the length, this way or this way, the change in length of the rod remains the same. So suppose you have an iron rod and you place the iron rod in a magnetic field applied in this direction. Suppose the length of the rod increases. Now suppose you reverse the field. Even if you reverse the field, the length of the rod will still increase only, it will not decrease. So whether you apply the field this way or this way, the change in length remains the same. So that's what is mentioned over here. The change in length of the rod is independent of the direction of the applied field. And what does it depend upon? It depends only upon the material of the rod. So whether the rod is made of iron, nickel or cobalt, so it depends on the material. Okay, and another thing it depends upon is the strength of the magnetic field which is applied. So you apply a stronger, larger magnetic field, the change in length will be also be larger. Okay, so if you apply a lesser magnetic field, the change in length also will be less. So iron, for example, when you place it in the magnetic field, it increases in length. Nickel, on the other hand, when you place it in the magnetic field, it reduces in length, decreases in length. And more the magnetic field you apply, the decrease in length in nickel will be more, it will decrease by a larger amount. In case of nickel. In case of iron, when you place it in a magnetic field, larger the magnetic field you apply, the increase in length of the iron rod will be larger. So iron, when you place it in the magnetic field, it increases in length. Nickel decreases in length when you place it in the magnetic field. So it depends on the material of the rod and the strength of the applied magnetic field. Now let's see now, using this phenomena of magnetostriction, how we can produce ultrasonic waves. Okay, so what we do over here is that we are going to place the ferromagnetic rod inside a solenoid. So imagine we have this ferromagnetic rod, iron rod, and we are going to place it inside a solenoid. What is a solenoid? It's basically a coil which is wound around this iron rod. And to this solenoid, let us say we apply a voltage. Let us say with a key over here. So basically we are passing a current I through the solenoid. Now remember, inside a solenoid, the iron rod, ferromagnetic rod is there. So moment we put the key, there will be a current I flowing in the circuit. And what will the solenoid generate? The solenoid generates a magnetic field along its axis. So the solenoid will generate a magnetic field along this direction, along its axis. Okay? So this will be the magnetic field B, which is produced along the center of the solenoid along its axis. So if you see, the rod which is inside the solenoid will be subjected to a magnetic field B, which is along its length, either parallel in this direction or opposite direction, but parallel to the length. Now, whether it's in towards the right or towards the left, what will it depend upon? It depends upon what direction the current is flowing. So, if the current is flowing clockwise using the Ampere's right hand rule, you can find out in what direction the magnetic field is there. So, if the magnetic field current is coiling in this direction, the magnetic field will be this side. If the current is coiling in this direction, the magnetic field will be that side. So, either case, the magnetic field is parallel to the length of the rod. So, the rod which is the ferromagnetic rod which is inside the solenoid is subjected to a magnetic field parallel to its length. So, what will happen? The rod will change in length. Either it will increase in size or decrease in size. So, let us assume this is an iron rod and it is increasing in size. So, the moment you put the key in the circuit, there will be a current, there will be a magnetic field produced, and the iron rod will increase in size. It will become slightly bigger. Now, suppose we remove the key out. What is going to happen? The moment you remove the key out, the current in the circuit will stop. The magnetic field also will become zero. And what will happen to the rod? The rod will come back to its original length. Okay? Again, if you put the key, again the rod will increase in size because again the magnetic field is produced by the solenoid. So, if you keep on alternating this, putting and removing the key out of the socket, what will happen is the rod will also increase in length, decrease in length alternately. And suppose you are able to put and remove the key at a very fast rate, let us say 1000 times in a second, you are putting and removing the key, what will happen? The rod will also increase in length and decrease in length. In other words, it will go out and in at the same rate at which you are putting and removing the key out. And suppose you are able to do this more than 20,000 times in a second. So the rod will also expand, contract, increase, decrease, out, in at the same rate 20,000 times in a second. So now these are vibrations. Out and in motions of the rod are basically vibrations. So if you are able to put and remove the key more than 20,000 times in a second, the rod will also vibrate at that same rate at which you are doing it. So the rod will also vibrate at a rate more than 20,000 times in a second, and it will produce ultrasonic waves. So this is the basic principle by which, using the phenomena of magnetostriction, we can produce ultrasonic waves. But now, there is only just one problem there. It is not possible mechanically or humanly to put and remove a key more than 20,000 times in a second. So you cannot do it manually. You cannot mechanically put and remove a key at such a large rate. So we have to work on some other way. Okay? We have to use some other method of doing this, making the field on and off at a very fast rate, more than 20,000 times in a second. So how can we do that? It's a very simple solution to this problem. What we do is, instead of using a DC source, let us use a AC source. So what are we going to do? We are going to replace this DC source with an AC source, what is going to happen then? So suppose I replace this with an AC alternating current source. Now, if we know in the AC, the current starts from zero, increases, becomes maximum, then comes back to zero, goes to the negative cycle, and then goes back to. So this is one cycle of the AC source. It has a positive cycle and a negative cycle. Now, if we apply such a signal to the solenoid, what is going to happen to the current and the magnetic field inside a solenoid? At, I'll label these points with letters. So let us say at point A, this point let us say is point A, this point is B, the peak point, this point let us say is C, this point is D, and this point is E. And this, remember, this line is the zero line, zero. Whenever the signal is along this line, the value of the voltage, current, field is zero. Now, at point A, the signal is at zero level. So what is going to happen? No current in the circuit, no magnetic field. So what is going to happen to the rod? So at point A, the rod is going to be its original length. Original length, unchanged length. Then, from point A, as we go towards point B, what is happening to the current in the circuit? It is increasing, it is rising. From A to B, the current is rising. So, magnetic field also will increase. As a result, what will happen is, the rod also will increase, start increasing in length. It will become maximum in length at point B, where the signal attains its peak value. So the current is maximum, the magnetic field is maximum at point B. So the at point B, the rod will become maximum in size. Then from B to C, the current is now reducing. So the magnetic field also is reducing. So as the magnetic field strength decreases, the rod will also start decreasing in length. And at point C, the magnetic field is back to its zero value. So at point C, when the magnetic field is zero, the rod will come back to its original length. So from B to C, the rod is decreasing in size, and at point C, the rod will come back from its maximum size to its original size. Then, what happens beyond C? Beyond C, the signal is decreasing in value. In value it is increasing, but it is becoming negative. So it's increasing in size, in magnitude it is increasing, but it is increasing in a negative direction. So in other words, the magnetic field produced by this coil will be reversing. So if during the positive cycle, the magnetic field was pointing in this direction inside the solenoid, in the negative cycle, the magnetic field will be pointing in the opposite direction. Okay? But as we had mentioned while discussing about magnet restriction, the direction of the magnetic field does not affect the change in the length of the rod. So if the field was applied this way and the rod had increased in length, even if you reverse the field, the rod still increases in length. It does not depend on the direction of the applied field. So now, from C to D, as the field is increasing in value but in the opposite direction, the rod will again start increasing in size because the strength of the magnetic field is increasing, though it's in the opposite direction. Okay, so the rod will again start increasing. So from C to D, the rod will increase. At point D, where the signal is maximum in value, maximum negative value there, the rod will again become maximum in size. And from D to E, the signal value is again decreasing. It's going back towards zero. So it's decreasing in value. And at point E, the signal value becomes zero. So the rod at point E will come back to its original unchanged length. So this is what happens in one full cycle of the AC signal. So at point A, it is original length. At point B, it has become maximum in length. At point C, it comes back to its original length. At point D, again it increases and becomes maximum. Again at point E, it comes back to its original length. So in one cycle, how many vibrations are there? How many in and out motions of the rod are there? So this is A, B, C. So from A to C, the rod has moved out and come back in. So one vibration. So in just one half cycle, A to C, the rod vibrates once. In the negative cycle again, the rod at point C, it is original length. At point D, again it goes out. And at point E, again it comes back in. So another vibration. So therefore, in one full cycle of the AC signal applied, the rod vibrates twice. There are two in and out motions. Original A, at B it is out, at C it is back in, at D it is again out, and at E again it is back in. So there are two in and out motions in one full cycle of the AC signal. So therefore, in one AC cycle, there are two vibrations of the rod. So now, suppose we apply a AC signal of frequency F. Okay, suppose the signal has a frequency F. At what rate will the rod inside the solenoid vibrate? The rod will vibrate at a frequency 2F. Why? Because in one cycle, there are two vibrations. So therefore, in F cycles, there will be 2F vibrations of the rod. And therefore, if F is anything greater than or equal to 10,000 Hertz, if the frequency of the applied signal F is more than 10,000, the rod inside the solenoid will vibrate at double that rate, more than 20,000 times per second. Okay, so this will be greater than or equal to 20,000 Hertz. So therefore, the rod will vibrate at a frequency greater than 20,000 Hertz and it will produce ultrasonic waves. So in magnetostriction method, the object which is vibrating and producing the ultrasonic waves is the ferromagnetic rod, which is placed inside the solenoid. And what is applied to the solenoid is an AC signal, which is required to produce the alternating magnetic field to which the rod is subjected. So this is the method this is the process by which we can produce ultrasonic waves using magnetostriction phenomena. Now, we can see some things over there. So what is this describes the process of magnetostriction. So if a ferromagnetic rod is placed in an alternating field of frequency F, the rod will change in length twice in each cycle, resulting in vibrations of frequency 2F. So this is what I just explained to you regarding the process of magnetostriction method, wherein you apply an AC signal to the solenoid. Now, if the frequency is greater than 10,000, the rod will vibrate at double the frequency and it will produce ultrasonic waves. Now, important thing is that for the ultrasonic waves which are produced by the vibrating rod, for the ultrasonic waves to be of large amplitude, we must make the rod to vibrate at its natural frequency. We are going to briefly discuss in details little bit more about its natural frequency. So now, if we make the rod to vibrate at its natural frequency, what is going to happen? The rod will vibrate at a resonance. There is a phenomenon called as resonance which will take place, and the amplitude of the vibrations of the rod will become very large, and that will produce large amplitude ultrasonic waves. Remember, it is always necessary to produce ultrasonic waves of large amplitude. If the amplitude of the ultrasonic waves which is produced is too small, then they will be of no use. So for example, suppose I am talking very softly. Okay, the amplitude of my sound is very soft and you are not able to hear it. Then what is the use of me talking? So in a similar way, if the ultrasonic waves which are produced have very less amplitude, we will not be able to use them for any purpose. So it's always necessary, therefore, then the waves, ultrasonic waves which are produced have to have large amplitude. And for that to happen, we must make the rod to vibrate at its natural frequency so that it will vibrate at resonance and produce large amplitude ultrasonic waves. So the natural frequency of a ferromagnetic rod, the formula for it is here. Fn is the natural frequency. It is 1 upon 2L root of Y upon rho. Now here L is the length of the rod, Y is the Young's modulus of the material of the rod, and rho is the density of the material of the rod. So if you are using an iron rod there, Y is the Young's modulus of iron, rho is the density of iron, and L will be the length of the rod. So what you see over here is that the natural frequency is inversely proportional to the length. Larger the length, lesser will be the natural frequency of that rod. Okay. So we'll briefly discuss a little bit more about this natural frequency and why it is, what is this phenomenon of resonance. Okay. Let's try to understand this phenomenon. So suppose we have a rod. Okay. Every rod has its own natural frequency depending upon its length, its material, and other factors. Okay. So shape of the rod, shape of the material, length of the material, what material the rod is made of. So let us say this rod has a natural frequency of 30,000 Hertz. Now, how can we determine the natural frequency? If you take an object and you strike it once, the object vibrates. And the frequency at which it vibrates is called its natural frequency. For example, if you take a bell and if you hit strike the bell, whatever vibrations, whatever sound is produced by that bell, that's the natural frequency of that bell. Okay? So if you change the shape of the bell, if you change the size of the bell, if you change the material of the bell, the sound produced will be all different. Okay? So every different object has its own natural frequency. So similar way, let us say this rod has a natural frequency of 30,000 Hertz. Now suppose if this rod is made to vibrate at exactly 30,000, so if you force the rod to vibrate at 30,000 Hertz, the rod will be able to vibrate with large amplitude and it will produce ultrasonic waves of large amplitude. But suppose we make the rod to vibrate only at, let us say, at 40,000. Suppose we make the rod to vibrate at 40,000 Hertz, will it produce ultrasonic waves? Yes, the rod will produce ultrasonic wave because 40,000 is more than 20,000. Anything more than 20,000 is ultrasonic. So the rod will produce ultrasonic waves of 40,000 Hertz, but they will not be of large amplitude. Why? Because 40,000 is not its natural frequency. 30,000 Hertz is the natural frequency of the rod. So only if you make the rod to vibrate at 30,000, it will produce ultrasonic waves of large amplitude. So this formula which I had written there, Fn is 1 upon 2n, root of pi upon rho. So this rod, if it has a natural frequency of 30,000 Hertz, you have to make it vibrate at 30,000 Hertz. Only then it will produce ultrasonic waves. So what we need to do therefore, in the solenoid, we have to apply a AC signal of what frequency? So the AC signal frequency must be F is equal to 15,000 Hertz. Why 15,000? Because when you apply 15,000 Hertz frequency to the solenoid, the rod will vibrate at double the frequency. F you apply, you get double the frequency generated. So if you apply 15,000, the rod will vibrate at 30,000. And 30,000 is the natural frequency of the rod. Hence, the rod will vibrate at resonance and it will produce large amplitude ultrasonic waves. So therefore, what is the process, procedure by which you are going to design this rod? How are you going to, suppose for a particular application, you require ultrasonic waves of frequency, let us say 80,000 Hertz. Suppose for a particular application, we require ultrasonic waves of 80,000 Hertz. So, how are we going to generate them? What is the process? How do we start? Okay, how do we proceed? What is the procedure required to be followed? This formula plays an important role over there. Fn is equal to 1 upon 2L, y upon rho. So, suppose you want ultrasonic waves of this frequency. In this formula, you are going to put Fn as 80,000. Put Fn as 80,000. Natural frequency, you put it as 80,000. And you calculate what is the L value. Y and rho values will be known to you. Suppose you are using iron rod. Young's modulus of iron and density of iron are known constants. So you can put those values there and calculate what L is equal to. So put Fn is equal to 80,000. And calculate using this formula. Calculate L using this formula. Okay? What is L? So suppose L comes out to be, let us say, 8 centimeters. Just example. So what are you going to do? Suppose you have a big rod of iron. You are going to cut a 8 centimeter length rod of that, Okay, 8 centimeters. And that rod, 8 centimeter rod, you are then going to place it inside a solenoid. So 8 centimeter rod, you are going to place it inside the solenoid over here. And then, what AC signal are going to apply? What is the frequency of the AC signal you are going to apply here? You are going to apply an AC signal of frequency 40,000, half the required value. So, when you apply frequency of 40,000, the rod inside that solenoid will vibrate at 80,000. And remember, 80,000 is the natural frequency of the rod because we have calculated it using the formula. So, the natural frequency of the rod is 80,000. So, when you apply 40,000, the rod will vibrate at 80,000, its natural frequency. It will vibrate with large amplitude at resonance and it will produce ultrasonic waves of frequency 80,000 Hertz, large amplitude. So, this is how we can generate ultrasonic waves of any value we want. You want 60,000 Hertz for any application, put in this formula Fn is 60,000, calculate L. Cut the rod in that particular length, place it inside a solenoid, apply frequency 30,000. So you apply 30,000, the rod vibrates at 60,000. 60,000 is the natural frequency. It produces ultrasonic waves of large amplitude of 60,000 Hertz. So this is the way by which, using the magnetosuction method, any frequency desired can be generated by cutting the rod in that particular length. Okay, so this is about the process by which we can generate ultrasonic waves of any desired frequency. So this formula is important. We're going to use this formula for problems also. So keep this in mind. Now we're going to study a circuit of a magnetostriction oscillator. So now, as we had seen earlier, over here we can see the rod is inside the solenoid. The rod is inside the solenoid, and we apply an AC signal. Now, this AC signal which you are going to apply 40,000 Hertz, for example, in this case it's 40,000. For generating that AC signal, you require a special electronic circuit called as an oscillator. Okay, so what is an oscillator? An oscillator is basically an electronic circuit by which you are able to generate an AC signal of whatever frequency you want. Okay, so now you can see in this circuit over here, there is a ferromagnetic rod, let us say iron rod, which is wound inside a solenoid. It's there, wound inside a solenoid, and to that, what is applied? There is a circuit which is connected there, an electronic circuit which is connected to this solenoid. So this entire circuit which you see here is the oscillator. It is the circuit which is required to produce the AC signal. So I'll just redraw that solenoid thing again. So suppose we have this solenoid here. What is applied to the solenoid? We apply an AC signal to the solenoid. Okay? And what is there inside the solenoid? Inside the solenoid, the ferromagnetic rod is there. Inside the solenoid, the rod is there over here. So now, you can compare this circuit with this. Okay? So we have the solenoid, we have the rod, and we have the AC signal. AC signal. So whatever you see on the left hand side, other than this solenoid and the rod, is this part, the AC signal. This is the oscillator. It's a circuit required to generate the AC signal. So this is basically a Colpitts oscillator. Okay, there are different types of oscillators. This oscillator configuration is called as a Colpitts oscillator. So what is the purpose of an oscillator? It is to generate an AC signal of whatever frequency we want. So what are the different parts in it? So I can divide this circuit into different parts. Okay, so this part from here to here is called as the amplifier circuit. This part to this part is the most important part of the circuit. It's the heart of the circuit. It's called as the tank circuit. This part is again an amplifier. It's a current amplifier. Current amplifier, and then the last part is the actual place where the ultrasonic waves are being generated by the vibrating rod inside the solenoid. So now let us just look at the tank circuit. Now what does the tank circuit consist of? It consists of an inductor L in parallel with the capacitor. So basically it's a LC, parallel LC circuit. Now whenever you apply a signal, a small DC signal, whatever supply is applied to the circuit, it's a DC signal. Plus and minus. Okay, this represents minus. The ground symbol basically represents negative terminal of the power supply. So whenever you switch on your DC power supply, what this tank circuit does is it generates very small AC signals. Very small AC signals. They are very tiny. You cannot directly use them for anything. You need to increase their size first. So the tank circuit, when you switch on this VCC power supply, DC power supply, it generates small AC signals. Now this small AC signals through this path, they are applied to the input of the amplifier. Now what you see over here, this thing T is a transistor. Okay? This is the base of the transistor, has three terminals, base. This is called an emitter, and this terminal here is called a collector. So base, emitter, and collector. Now, what is the purpose of a transistor? You must have studied that transistor can be used as an amplifier. It can be used to amplify electrical signals. And that is what exactly this transistor T is doing in this circuit. Okay? So, this AC signals, these small AC signals from the tank circuit which are coming through this path, to this point here, they are going to the base of the transistor. So, the input point is the base. And the collector point is the output. At the collector, a large AC signal is generated, okay, by this transistor. A large AC signal is generated by the transistor at its collector point. So, what a collector does, what a transistor does, the small AC signal which was received from the tank circuit, it amplifies it and makes it large. And then, this AC signal is then, through this path, given to the current amplifier, so that its current level also is increased. And then, the amplified AC signal is applied to the solenoid with the ferromagnetic rod inside it. Now, you can see these two capacitors C3 and C4, they are variable capacitors. Why they need to be variable, why they are not fixed capacitors? The purpose of this capacitor C3 and C4 is to change the frequency of this circuit. Remember what I talked about resonance. If you want to make this rod to vibrate with large amplitude, we must be able to apply a AC signal of frequency half the natural frequency. So, for example, if the natural frequency of this rod is FN, the circuit must be able to generate an AC signal of frequency FN by 2. So that when FN by 2 frequency is applied, the rod will vibrate at double that, which is FN, and it will produce ultrasonic waves of large amplitude. So therefore, what is required is that this circuit, its frequency must be adjustable to whatever value we want. For example, suppose FN is 50,000, rod's natural frequency is 50,000. What is the AC signal which you need to generate? Frequency should be 25,000. So we have to make it exactly 25,000. How to do it exactly 25? By this variable capacitors. So by changing the value of this capacitors, we can adjust the frequency to whatever value we want, so that resonance will occur and the rod will produce ultrasonic waves of large amplitude. So this is the general circuit of a magnetostriction oscillator. It has a tank circuit which generates the AC signals, sine wave signals, amplifier circuit which raises the voltage level of the signals. Then there is also a current amplifier which raises the current level of the signals. Why do we need to raise the current level? Because more the current, greater will be the strength of the magnetic field produced by the solenoid. Okay, so that's the reason why we require a current amplifier also in this circuit. And then finally, the AC signal is applied to the solenoid, and the actual generation of ultrasonic waves takes place by the rod over here. So the vibrating rod is the one which actually produces the ultrasonic waves. Now, magnetostriction method has a slight limitation. Okay, it can produce ultrasonic waves of frequency maximum about 100 kilohertz. Okay, so that's the limitation of it. You cannot produce ultrasonic waves of frequency above 100 kilohertz using magnetostriction method. The reason is because of the rod size. If you see the formula which we had seen earlier, this formula Fm is equal to 1 upon 2L root of y by rho. What can you see from this? If you want a higher frequency, length must be less. Length must be smaller. Now, you cannot reduce the size of a rod to a very small value. Imagine you have a very small rod like this and you're placing it inside a big solenoid. The efficiency will not be there. The circuit will not be effectively able to produce ultrasonic waves of large amplitude. So, the rod should be of considerable size. So, this limitation regarding the length of the rod is what introduces a limit on the maximum frequency which you can generate using the magnetostriction method. So, maximum frequency is something around 100 kilohertz using the magnetostriction method. So, if you want to generate ultrasonic waves above 100 kilohertz, you have to use a different method that's called as a piezoelectric method. Okay, so this method will be studying in the next class.